For service delivery, the government will give you money. For advocacy, the government will never give you money because it's very difficult for any politician to empower the very body that will hold him or her accountable. So historically, what has happened is service delivery is funded by the government, but when a community feels strongly enough about advocating for certain issues, they pay out of their own pocket. And it's true for many, many advocacy organizations. The reason why I dwell on advocacy also and I bring it up is because, make no mistake, even though CAFCAN is service delivery, CAFCAN will never get the funding that it deserves because unless it's accompanied by an outside body that advocates on its behalf. In other words, historically, the monies that go to service delivery organizations are not based on need. They're based on the advocacy behind it. So my humble advice would be to make sure that for CAFCAN to reach its true potential and for CAFCAN to tackle all the problems that are in our community that they want to have the forum to tackle, we need to help them with the advocacy in order so that they can get the funding that they need. Not the funding that other people think they need, but the funding that they truly need. To do that, we need a segment of our community who do advocacy and who advocate on behalf of CAFCAN. That's extremely important because a lot of times our communities think that because we have these problems, that the problems themselves will create the merit argument for funding. Well, that's not the case. When you want to get funding, it's not just a question of highlighting the problem, but it's also a question of making sure that you can sell your case to the right people, making sure that you are involved in the political process so that the folks who make the decisions, i.e. the politicians, know about your case, know about your pitch, and continue to be in their face. I'll relate to one point about results with respect to advocacy. So there was an organization that did a study of Ottawa, Parliament Hill, the US Congress, and the UK Parliament. And they studied a number of various groups that were doing advocacy and or lobbying, trying to change government policy or trying to amend certain things. So they looked at that over a long period of time, and their results were very surprising. Normally, if you ask the regular person, you say, you know, in the US or in Canada, which groups of lobbyists or advocates get listened to by the politicians? Most people would say the ones with the most money. But this study proved that that wasn't the case. Yes, money is important for advocacy, but it's not the only thing. In fact, when they looked at the results, they said that the community groups that got the best results out of the politicians were not the ones who had the most money, but were the ones who were consistent and who never gave up, who spent the most time going back and kept pushing the issue. So consistency and the ability to play the long game and the ability to think between elections is really important. If you can get involved in the political process, not just during elections, but between elections, making sure that you're pushing the community's case. And CAFCAN can't do that because CAFCAN is doing the service delivery. They're prohibited in the amount of advocacy that they can do. But there has to be another group of people in the community who do the advocacy. And the lion's share of advocacy, I find, because most people are of goodwill, is education. Once you educate a person about your issue, you're halfway there. The rest is just convincing them about details and all that. But education is key. So if the advocates who are going to advocate on behalf of CAFCAN can focus on that, can educate folks on the issues facing our community, that's half the battle. Secondly, you'll be surprised. surprised at how much you can get out of volunteers. But the volunteers themselves have to see a benefit from getting involved in CAFCAN and or the JCA. And I'm not telling you anything you don't know, but I felt that it's important to reiterate that we have to make sure a lot of, I see when I go around, I see a lot of young people from our communities who we don't utilize enough. And so other organizations tend to utilize it. And my humble contention is that this is where they need it the most. And so what I mean by that is if you take a 14-year-old and you treat them like a child, they'll stay in that state. But if you challenge them and you give them more responsibilities, they'll rise up to those responsibilities. So we have to challenge our young people, we have to trust them, and we have to include them to make sure that they step up and they do things that they couldn't think that were possible. And we will benefit from that, because as a community, they will really come up with their enthusiasm and make sure that they improve the community. And in the process, they'll also improve themselves, acquire skills that will lead them to become better citizens and better human beings.